Good morning, church family. My name is Cameron Sheard. I will be your worship leader today. Please stand for the call to worship. Today is a gift from God. We gather on the edge of a milestone. We offer what we have to give, ourselves and our stirrings of our hearts and minds. Let us bless God. We gather to celebrate graduates who will look back over the way they have come and ahead to where they have not yet walked. Excited, scared, ready. We gather to thank God for parents and family members, teachers and administrators, religious leaders and church members who coached, challenged, and encouraged and risked the passion and hope our graduates would not only turn the tassel, but believe in themselves as gifted, lovable people who are contributors to the world that needs them. Tradition and vision mean so much to us. God, love, justice, faith, hope, kindness, the Ten Commandments, and the Great Commandments. With you, we have continued to learn the ways of peace and life. May the holy and divine life of the Word be a pathway for those of them that commence on their journey. We will now have our litany of our graduates by Mariah Owens.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I will be reading the litany of celebration for our graduates, which can be found in your home. Or program. We are gathered together to celebrate the accomplishments of members of our community.
We give blessings to you for all that you have achieved and many more achievements yet to come.
One part of your life's journey is complete. You will prepare to begin another phase that will take you to unimaginable places. As you prepare for this next journey, we hope that you remember the ones you leave behind, who have loved and supported you throughout the years.
We give you the blessings of good and will and love as you journey forth in the world. Thank you for that, for your fellowship, and to share with us. And pray that you begin your next journey. Remember the times that the Lord has shared with you.
Use those memories as a beacon to guide you on your path. Don't look back, continue only forward, while using those memories to create a new path. Because we are made in the image of God, we have been blessed with free will to make choices and decisions. Altogether, we pray that you make wise and rational decisions, always turning to God for help. God hears, God listens, God is always with you. Do not forget that. Always keep in mind that God is around, and if you turn to him, he will guide you. Thank you.
Please bow your heads for the invocation. Dear Lord, please let these graduates think about their achievements and learn from their mistakes, and now that they're going to this next phase in their life, be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
We will now have our congregation.
Thank you.
We will have our hero presentation from John and Jacob Henderson, class of 2013.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'll be doing a presentation on Janet Emerson Benson. Our she hero of the day is Janet Bashan Emerson Bashan. She is a current day business owner and inventor. The business is well known, for her ownership and for her chief executive officer of the Bashan Corporation of Houston, Texas. She became the first African-American woman to hold a patent on web-based software. Her software is named LinkedIn. This software allows management to track equal employment, opportunity claims, and reports. Currently, she is developing another web-based system for managing alternative action plans. Her educational experience includes attendance at Alabama A&U University and Rice University. According to Mrs. Bashan, her success is due to a few firm commitment to succeed.
Succeed we must.
I am. Jacob Henderson.
John Henderson.
Currently enrolled at Kansas State University and a graduate of Pennsauken High School. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. We will have a song by Sierra Irizarry.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We do better than that.
Good morning.
Thank you. I want to give an honor to God for waking me up this morning and starting me on my way. Trouble comes and I can't find an answer. Lonely nights I sleep in agony. All my friends are gone and I have no one else to turn to. So here I'm asking on my knees, it's me again, Lord. I got a prayer that needs an answer. It's me again, Lord. I got a problem I can't solve. Well, I don't mean to worry you, but here I am facing something new. I need the help that only comes from you. It's me again, Lord. You can clap. It's me again, Lord. I got a prayer that needs an answer. It's me again, Lord. I got a problem I can't solve. Something new, I need the help that only comes from you. It's me again, Lord. Trouble comes and I can't find an answer. Lonely nights I sleep in agony. Oh, my friends are gone and I have no one else to turn to. So here I am, I'm asking one more time. It's me again, Lord. I got a prayer that needs an answer. It's me again, Lord. I got a problem I just can't solve. Well, I don't mean to worry you, but here I am facing something new. I need the help that only comes from you. It's me again, Lord. It's me again, Lord.
Have spoken word and poetry by Fatima Wharton, class of 2012, and Darnell Butler.
Society favors. While Satan mothers negativity, we struggle to reach positive ends, distracted by what society wants, failure and drama with phony friends. Our unity is demolished by envious spirits, causing families to fall apart. Our daughter's bearing her mother's pain while our son scattered the seeds of his father's destruction. Hereditary cycles are becoming purposeful and not natural, led by false leaders and lost followers. We live in a clone society where no one realizes difference is beautiful, and we need to flip the script to the one that held dope to holding the diploma, from the vixen to the valedictorian, from the pole to the pulpit, to the ones that struggled and made it. I am proud of you. I am proud of you. So while Satan continues to mother negativity, we shall strive for positive ends. We need to flip the script because it's in this world we either soar or we don't exist.
Hello, everybody. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We are the Creative Arts Small Group Jazz Band, and today we will be playing Weak, the gospel version of SWV. By SWV and Gretchen Parlato.
Thank you.
that you're doing, but it's causing me heck in such a crazy way. Whatever it is that you do, what you do when you're doing, it's just a feeling I want to stay. But your love is strong, it keeps on holding on. Strength is down when you're around, pride fading. In my condition, I don't want to be alone. Cause my heart starts beating triple time with thoughts of praising you.
never marched for 7 days. The walls of the city just fell away. He bit the body off. He bit the body off. Joshua led God's people through. The Lord will do the very same thing for you. He bit the body off. He bit the body off.
The battle of Jericho. They didn't even see the enemy no more. He fought the battle of Jericho. And the walls came tumbling down. They came tumbling down. So whenever you go through your problems and your burdens too, just know that the Lord will bring the victory to you. He fought the battles of your Jericho. So watch the walls come tumbling down. They'll come tumbling down. The battle of Jericho. They didn't even see the enemy no more. He fought the battle of Jericho. And watch the walls come tumbling down. They came tumbling down. So whenever you go through your problems and your burdens too, just know that the Lord will bring the victory to you. He fight the battles of your Jericho. And watch the walls come tumbling down. They'll come tumbling down.
Good morning. I'm very excited about doing this introduction, and when I get to the end of her bio, you will understand why. Dr. Anika Warren currently serves as Associate Vice President for Foundation and Corporate Relations in the Office of Institutional Advancement at Drexel University. As Associate Vice President, Anika leads the university's outreach and philanthropic engagement with major foundations and corporations to support strategic goals and major institutional programs, and she works closely with President John A. Fry to advance Drexel's presence regionally, nationally, and internationally. Prior to Anika joining Drexel, she established an LLC where she provided consulting, coaching, and psychological counseling to clients and patients. She also worked as a senior director of research and global member services at Catalyst Incorporated. Dr. Warren has been overseeing between $25 and $30 million each year of the university fundraising, as well as the philanthropic executive leadership team, which she's responsible for $75 million annually for education and research. Anika, prior to her present position, was working at Columbia University as an advisor for doctoral students. She was very comfortable in that position, and one day Drexel University came a knocking. They told her they want her in Philadelphia, and the rest is history. After the next selection, the next voice you will hear is that of my cousin, Dr. Anika Warren, our speaker of the hour.
We will have a dance ministry selection from Takria Hawkins, class of 2012.
He saw the best in me when everyone else around can only see the worst in me. Can I tell y'all one more time? I said he saw the best in me. When everyone else around could only see the worst in me.
All right.
I wish I had a witness tonight. All I need is one. Hey!
He saw the best in me.
When everyone else around me, yeah.
Only see the worst in me.
Does anybody have that testimony? When folk walked you off, said you would never make it, what did he see?
He saw the best in me.
When everyone else around me, yes, oh.
When everyone else around,
yeah.
Could only see the worst in me.
Can I tell y'all one more thing? I just need to tell you one more thing. And I am his. It doesn't matter what I did. He only sees me for who I am. Does anybody know that tonight? Oh, see, he is mine. And I am his. Said it doesn't matter what I did. See, he only sees me.
Beautiful. Thank you, cousin, for the introduction. I'd like to thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for allowing me to live, learn, and love, and for allowing me to be here with you today. I'd also like to thank Reverend Dr. Britt Stargell for his fortitude and commitment to Kaign Avenue Baptist Church, the city of Camden, to God, and for inviting me to speak to you at this very special Baccalaureate Sunday, which is also Pentecost Sunday. I'd be remiss if I did not also thank the organizers of this event, one of which called me last week and told me the title was flipping the script. So,
I thank you for that. Dr. William Maddox. I'd also like to thank my family and friends who are here in the audience, those that I know in the pews and those who have yet to meet. On the way here, my grandmother, Lillian Warren, told me that she was baptized here at Kaign Avenue. My father was also baptized here at Kaign Avenue Baptist Church. And both sets of my great-grandparents attended church here. So it is very special for me to be with all of you here today. I just arrived back in the country on Friday, so I'm a little tired. I reflected a little bit yesterday, and I think I have a few things to share. Before I begin, I'd like to walk around. We've all heard a lot of people ask a common question, and I'm going to ask you right now. Can anything good come out of Camden, New Jersey? And we all know the answer to that question. But of course, I am, you are, and we all shall be. Camden folks not only flipped the script, but I am a living example of how we have come full circle and evidence that it is a good thing. Everything in life has good and bad aspects to it. We all know that life is beautifully bittersweet. You'll hear several examples of what I've just described in the comments that I'm going to make today. I'm going to talk about the circle of life, the history of our people, the power of the Holy Ghost. They're all real and relevant to what I will speak about. I'm wearing red underneath my regalia in honor of what we call Pentecost Sunday. As many of you are aware, wearing red today symbolizes the fire of the Holy Spirit. I pray that God's Spirit fills me in a way that you can hear my words, let them resonate in your spirit, and walk out as a new and changed person. I tend not to use speaking notes, but if I don't, I'll be here all day. So I'll use them as a guide. One of the things my cousin Dion didn't mention is I was a doctoral level professor, and I'm also an author. So one of the first things you learn when you're educating others is you have to make sure everybody is on the same page, speaking the same language, so we can share our common knowledge. So to do that, I want to just make sure we're talking about the same thing when we talk about flipping the script. It means reversing or using existing positions in a situation. It says, it's what happens when we do something unexpected or revolutionary. Flipping the script takes what someone said against you and using it against them. To gain control that you are not now in charge of something you once weren't. You know, sometimes what happens is someone does something deceitful to you and you forgive them. As a Christian, that's the right thing to do. And then they take your kindness for weakness and think they have the upper hand. Well, when it's time to flip the script like we do here in Camden, what do? You turn around and do the exact same thing to them, right? And then they never know what happened. Gotcha. So as we talk about flipping the script, we have to be honest. I said there's good and bad in life. There's good and bad in all of us. And flipping the script has negative connotations as well. Some people deem it as being hypocritical, two-faced, or sanctimonious. Okay, so are we all clear about what flipping the script could mean, at least in part? Okay, I want to also talk about circles. Circles, they're commonly representing unity, wholeness, and infinity. Without a beginning or an end, without sides and corners. The circle is also associated with the number one. There are several biblical references about oneness and one. I am not a theologian, so I'm going to focus on circles right now. The circle, in some cases, has many distinctions in that you can be contained within a circle and with outside of a circle, right? So sometimes your circle could protect you from danger. Conversely, a circle can also contain you in a way where you lose out on sharing your goodness and the graces. So when we think about each day of our life and each day on the universe, we know one thing. There is morning, noon, and night, right? And each day, the world circles and replenishes and starts anew. As the earth orbits the sun, the moon orbits the earth. All three of those are what? Circles. I've come full circle myself. The circle of life is symbolic. It represents birth, survival, and death. Some circles are considered kind of more complex than others. Constant loops, overlapping circles. People are constantly being born and dying. There is a spiritual element to circles too, right? Because we are promised eternal life. Remember, the earth, the sun, and the moon are all circles. But let's not forget one important thing about the sun. The sun is not only a circle, it's also a star, right? So if the sun is also a star, and the nearest star to the earth is the sun, which is the source of most of our energy, there's a deep connection here for all of us to recognize. So when we think about the stars, there's not just the sun, there are many, many, many stars in the galaxy. And at night, we see them very clearly. But please never forget that each of you are a star, and you too shine in divine ways. And in the middle of the day, even when the sky is clear, those stars are still shining. During the night, when some of us are asleep, and others, some of you in the pew, may be doing other things, we are dreaming, right? And it's not daydreaming. They're real dreams. So I just want to make sure, are we all on the same page about flipping the script, circles of life, and the sun? I see you shining over there. I like your smile. Now I want to talk to you a little bit about how I flipped the script and came full circle. I'm from Camden, New Jersey. I was born at Our Lady of Lourdes right around the corner. I come from generations of Camden-born and raised family members. When I was 6 years old, my parents moved to Seattle, and eventually, as my cousin Dion referenced, I became a doctor, and I spent about the greater part of the last 14 years in New York City doing many, many things, oftentimes having two full-time jobs and a part-time job on the side, and still trying to find some time for fun in the sun. So in 2003, one of my full circles occurred when I moved about 7 miles from here to Philadelphia. And now, here I am, speaking to you today. I'm gonna talk briefly about my journey, but what I'm here to focus on is you and who we are as a collective people. As people, I want to ennoble each and every one of you, particularly the graduates and the students that are here in the congregation. If it wasn't for God, our ancestors, and my own family legacy, and each person who has encouraged, as well as those who have discouraged me, I would not be here today. Every move I have made in my life, it's not been for a man, and it's not been for money. It's been for professional and educational opportunities. So before I get deep, I want to ask you guys a question. I want you to tell me what you think and how you think the following things are common. What is common amongst them? Retail salesperson, author, investment banker, model, college professor, global speaker, auditor, teacher, psychologist, consultant, researcher, actor, vice president, high school counselor, artist, Camden, Seattle, San Francisco, Boston, Washington, D.C., New York, Maryland, Oakland, Europe, Latin America, Asia, flawed, human, sinner, Christian, servant. What do those things have in common? They are all me. That is right. Some of the places that I've traveled, the careers I've had, places I've lived, where I've worked, these careers and experiences might sound very diffuse to you. They might sound different from one another, and they may seem like they're all over the map, all over the universe, but they're not. They are core to my priorities and competencies, to my identity as a Christian, my identity as a woman, my identity as a proud Black American. I work through my gifts, and despite my flaws, to improve my relationship with God, because I'm gonna keep it real. My goal is to get into heaven by helping, healing, learning, creating, growing, loving, and using my analytical, emotional, intellectual, social, and spiritual gifts to create success for me and hopefully to help you do the same thing. I got through my degrees with a common mantra, a mantra that I created for myself. I'm going to say it, and then I'm going to ask you all to repeat it. Do your best and allow God to do the rest. Can you say that with me? Do your best and allow God to do the rest. I made it through because of the Holy Ghost. In my weakest moments, when I was not feeling confident, when I was tired and stressed, I did that, and I also did one other thing. I used my knowledge of our common history. I used my understanding of what it meant to be African American to inspire me. I read Black poetry in the midst of a storm. I read about historical events that have affected my people. I did all of that to remember why we and I must continue to fight. Getting on my knees in prayer and counting it all joy. One of my favorite scriptures is James 1:2-3. So, in the middle of a trial, I count it all joy. Leaning on optimism and hope of previous generations, creating a sense of confidence, maintaining a positive attitude, and owning my challenges and pains as well as my inadequacies. Through motivation, inspiration, and vision, I think about what my own legacy will be and our legend as a people. Remember, the Holy Spirit did it, not me. Remember, that Spirit is within you, each and every one of you. So you need to read and reflect so that when we look at what we have accomplished in spite of all that we've become, we can say it is because God is. How many of you can look back on your life, I don't care if you're 6 or 60, how many of you can look back on your life and say, how did I get here? Well, it's Pentecost Sunday. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. Look, I ain't perfect. And I don't try to pretend I am. I might look nice because I'm a little shallow. But I try to live peaceful, I try to be happy, and I try to be authentic. Like most human beings, I seek love that is reciprocal, and I find that first in my faith, second in myself, and third through maintaining healthy relationships at work, even when it's not fun, and at home. And by walking away from things that have a tendency to bring drama, right, and inflate you down to where you couldn't be, right? Because that's no good, because life comes, and what I like to say to people sometimes is I'm a psychologist and I'm a human being. I like drama in two places, in the therapy room and on my television. So one of the lessons that I continue to learn in my life is the importance of relationships, the challenges that come from relationships, the good ones, the great ones, and the bad ones. And the reality that if we want to be happy and successful, we have to work through all of them. Our relationship with God, with our family, with our friends, with those who hurt us, and like I like to say, even the relationships with our haters and our blockers. They are out there too, right? No one is immune to that. So it's through those things that we fully embrace our own beauty. Now I want to talk specifically to the graduates and the students, the talent and the musicians and the future generation. I personally learned, because I work with a lot of CEOs and executives and entrepreneurs, that to be a strong leader, you must be a follower. Follow rules, follow people, and follow others' examples. You must watch and listen even when people think you're not paying attention. You must own your limitations, your good and your bad. Don't deny parts of you or parts of our history. Being excellent means knowing our exceptional and often hostile history as a Black American people, as African Americans. Listen, I'm gonna be honest. I watch sports, I watch the news, I love reality TV and crime shows just like the rest of you. It's good stuff. I Google things, I read about celebrities, I giggle. I love to shop. Shopping can be exciting. I do all that. And my family over here, they'll tell you I love food, fashion, and fun. So I'm human. I'm no different than many of you. And my accomplishments don't define me. It's my inner spirit, my goals, and how I love and connect with all of you that defines me, right? So we're all the same in God's eyes, whether we are a homeless pauper or a person with 15 degrees. We're all equal. Let's not get it twisted. So I enjoy hip hop, jazz, classical, or Christian music just the same. But my true spirit, inspiration, and spirit comes from knowing my heritage, knowing our shared history as Black people. I try to inspire and ennoble myself by learning about our legacy. I've said that before, and I'm gonna tell you a little bit more about how I do that. I encourage each and every one of you to gain more knowledge about more noteworthy African Americans who can serve, as you said, as role models, mentors, and aspirants. Even if they are not alive on earth now, even if they don't look like us, right? You can find people who will inspire you. Because when you're a pioneer and a trailblazer, like I aspire to be a president of a university, sometimes you just don't have a lot of examples that look like you. They may not be your race, they may not be your gender, they may not be from your social or your class or your financial background. But the goal in all of this is to what? Find inspiration that allows you to pursue your ideas, your interests, and gain new insights. I'm gonna get a little deep, okay? The deep footprint that we have had has been made by our ancestors. If you want true inspiration and motivation when you're feeling sad or lazy, uninspired, confused, disappointed, hopeless, overwhelmed, or even when you're feeling like you are the bomb, you are the thing, right? When you think it's all going on good for you and you are fabulous and excellent, what I encourage you to do is pick up a book, and it's so easy, you could just search the internet and learn more about our people, African American inventors, surgeons, artists, historians, entrepreneurs, business leaders, teachers, technicians, pioneers, and survivors. There are so many exceptional Black people who have come before us that you could read every day for the rest of your life and never know our history. And what makes it so amazing, as we have so much to read, partly because brilliance is being born every day. I don't have a time check, so I'm just gonna keep on rolling. So, I just want to say one other thing. There is excellence in the sanctuary. There is excellence in each and every one of you. Uncover and unpack your gifts. I'd like to take you on a little journey if I haven't already. I encourage you to listen to what I'm saying. Listen for the power, Pentecost Sunday. Listen for the power, regardless of whether you're 7, 17, 70, or older. I want you to hear what I'm about to say and think biblically, spiritually, intellectually, physically, emotionally, socially, and professionally about what it means to us as a people and to you as an individual. I know, Grandma, I'm not supposed to point. Sorry. I want to talk a little bit about perseverance. Black family history is about suffrage, survival, and success. If you don't know it, how can you live up to it? Slavery separated us. If we all know that, and we all know that a weakened Black community has emerged from slavery, right? As a consequence, today, over 70% of African-American children are born to unmarried women in America. That number is an astonishing residual of slavery. Whether you trace it back or not, it's not your grandparents that did it.
We've all heard that there's a direct correlation, a direct link between the absent father and what? Yes, two things primarily. Dropout rates of high school students, and I think that's evidence in the number of people we have here in the audience, right? And higher levels of criminal records. But we all know success stories of Black African Americans who have come from every type of adversity that we can imagine. I don't know how many of you had the gumption to see 12 Years a Slave, but check it out, because it is real. Suffrage every day. So I have more heroes and sheroes than I can name and count, so I'm not gonna bore you with all of them, but I can tell you about a few. Some of these stories may be familiar to some of you, some may not, but I hope with each story you learn a little bit more about someone you thought you knew. First, I'm gonna talk about my friend Wilma. When Wilma was 4 years old, it was the mid-1940s, she was diagnosed with polio. Polio causes people to be crippled and unable to walk. To make matters worse, her family was poor and could not afford good medical care. How many of you know how big Wilma Rudolph's family was? It was so large, she was the 20th of 22 children. You talk about kid poor. If you want to have money, you reduce the number of kids you have. I ain't got none. Her father was a railroad porter and her mother was a maid. Her mother was dedicated to making sure that Wilma would walk again. She got on buses, she took her to doctors, and they said, there's nothing that you can do. Wilma will never walk. She went to another doctor far away, and he said, what I suggest you do is give her a massage. Rub her feet, rub her legs every day. So when Wilma's mother got home, she had hands to help her. And she asked Wilma's sisters and brothers to rub her legs every day. By the time she was 8, Wilma could walk with a leg brace. After that, she used one high-top shoe to support her foot. She played basketball with her brothers every single day. And just a few short years later, when she was 11 years old, her mother walked home to find Wilma doing what? Nah, she wasn't running yet. She was playing basketball all by herself, barefoot. Yep. Later on, some people think they know Wilma, and they told you, a coach told her, you should run. And she ran so fast that her senior year in high school, she qualified for the 1959 Olympics in Australia. She won a bronze medal for a relay, a 400 relay. But guess what? 3 years later, she not only qualified for the Olympics in Rome, Italy in 1960, but she also broke the world record. And in those Olympics, she won a gold medal at the 100 meter and the 200 meter. And guess what? It's come full circle because she sprained her ankle. Not too bad, because she worked through the pain and she ran with her team and they became the gold medal winners of the 400 meter. So Wilma won 3 gold medals that year. She retired at the young age of 22 and she knew that God wasn't done with her. But I want to make sure everyone knows who Wilma Rudolph is. Have you heard that name? Did some of you guys think I was talking about Wilma Flintstone with all the discussion of feet? I'm just checking. So we have to count it all joy, right? All the victories. Well, guess what Wilma decided to do after she retired? Not only was she a coach and an inspirer, she started her own foundation. And her foundation focused on helping youth understand the importance of hard work, right? Well, I'm going to share a few quotes with you today. I got a whole bunch of them in my head, and I'll try not to share my favorite. But I'm going to share one from Wilma. If you haven't figured out what I'm about to say, does anyone know where I'm going with this? Okay. So here we go. Never underestimate the power of dreams and the influence of the human spirit. We're all the same in this notion. The potential for greatness lives within each and every one of us. Let's talk about another hero of mine, the Shiro. His name is Langston. Does anyone know his full name? No, that ain't his full name. Educate. His full name is James Mercer Langston Hughes. One of his role models, Paul Lawrence Dunbar. I heard you guys were talking about him here yesterday. Let me tell you, Langston Hughes has a very special place in my heart because he was one of the main authors that I read when I was in graduate school. I have 4 degrees, so I did a lot of reading. So what I want to tell you about Langston is not only was he a poet, an activist, a novelist, a playwright, and a columnist, he too suffered just like many of you. He was an inventor of what we once called, which was then known as jazz poetry. He's an African American, and he is best known as a leader of the Harlem Renaissance. But many of people don't know this part of his suffrage. Langston Hughes' parents divorced when he was very young. His father moved to Cuba and then to Mexico because he didn't want to deal with racism in the United States anymore. So he was raised by his maternal grandmother till the age of 13. Many people here were probably raised by grandparents. So what's interesting is at the age of 13, he moved to Cleveland. He moved to stay with his mother and his mother's husband, who wasn't his father. He then went on to Columbia. He received some degrees, but he had odd jobs too. And this is when we have to remember, nothing is beneath us, no matter what we have done and accomplished. Throughout his struggles, he worked as an assistant cook, a launderer, and a busboy. He traveled through Africa and Europe as a seaman. His sense of dedication, he really gained through his grandmother and one of his great-grandfather's brothers. But what I think is most important about Langston is he talks about his struggle. His poetry keeps it real. What is the experience of Black African Americans? How do we love? How do we laugh? How do we live? But what he says is, at a young age while living with his grandmother, the challenge that he really faced was the deep despair and depression of being neglected by his parents. But what did it do? It drove, where did his loneliness take him? Not to the hood, not to the drugs. It took him to books and the wonderful world that you can discover in a book, in words. So that is one of the parts of Langston Hughes' story that I just wanted to share with all of you. I'll also share a quote about him. So I didn't tell you this. Wilma Rudolph, she died of brain cancer. Langston Hughes died of prostate cancer on May 22nd in 1967. At the time that he died, he was actually living in our mutual friend's grandmother's home, taking care of her while she had cancer, because she was a good cook and it felt like home to him as well. Because I'm so interested in Langston Hughes, in a conversation with this mutual friend of ours, he talked about some work that his father had authored along with Langston Hughes back when they were students at Lincoln University, okay? And he said it's not known, it's not very well published, and it talks about the experience of Black Americans in college at the time. It's funny. The stuff they ate, scrapple, and how they talk about it, it's interesting, but it's an important study. But I'm gonna read a part of a passage that opens the book that Langston wrote, okay? You know what the theme is gonna be? You haven't figured it out yet? I keep coming full circle, but y'all ain't rolling with me. In the primitive world, where people live closer to Earth and much nearer to the stars, every inner and outer act combines to form the single harmony, life. Every movement of life becomes part of our education. The stars are never far away. The strength of the surest dream is the strength of the primitive world. So again, we have oneness, we have circles, we have stars, we have earth, we have humanness, we have dreams, we have strength, we have life, and we have self through education. I mean, I could go on. I could talk to you about Charles Drew. I could talk to you about Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois. I could talk to Paul Lawrence Dunbar, right? I can tell you, because I like opera, I'm a little geeky, that there are over 65 Black American, African American opera singers that are world renowned, including Kathleen Battles and Leontine Price, One of my favorites that isn't an opera singer, but she's also a poet, is Audre Lorde. And I said I wasn't going to share her quote, and I won't share the Booker T one about obstacles, but it's a good one. But I'm going to share this Audre Lorde quote because I feel it in my spirit. When I dare to use my power in service of my vision, then it becomes less and less important whether I'm afraid. Another favorite of mine that she says is, feel the fear and do it anyway. So I also want to talk, I'm a psychologist, so there's Mamie and Kenneth Clark, Claude Steele, Janet Helms, my mentor, but also from Camden, you have a lot of greats. We saw that brother Groovin on the drums. There's a jazz drummer that some of the older folks here might know. Butch Ballard from Camden, right? We all know Lola Falana, men loved her. My Uncle George used to always talk about Lola Falana when I was young. Somehow I remember that. So I also want to talk about a contemporary. Many of you may not know, but one of the leading CEOs of a Fortune 100 company, multi-billion dollar company, is a black woman named Ursula Burns. And I have a hero that I have had the honor of hearing speak on profound amounts of times. His name is Freeman Hrabowski, and he's black. He's a mathematician, he focuses on STEMs, he's an educator, and he is the president of University of Maryland Baltimore campus. What's interesting about his presidency is he's known by both US News and World Report and Times as one of the most influential people existing now. His university is the number one up-and-coming university in the country. He is a top 10 president of the United States. There are over 3,000 to 5,000 colleges and universities in this country, depending upon you how you slice and dice, and he is a top 10. So when you don't know your history, what inspires you? So I'm going to close, but I'm not going to do like the pastors do, and they keep closing, and they keep closing, and they keep closing. Right? I just want the students and the graduates to remember a few things. Define your own success, and remember that many successful people have a few things in common. They listen and never stop learning. They practice and persevere. They admit when they're wrong. They know what they don't know, and they know when to ask for help. They dream, they help others, and they accomplish and complete their goals. That's one of the plights of the black community is people start stuff, but they can't finish it. Complete it. Get through. Understand yourself. Know your truth. Own it. Work through it. And don't allow others to define you in negative and hostile ways, whether they're in your family or in your friendship network. They can still be crude and rude. People will try to put you in your place or check you and tell you they're keeping it real. I'm keeping it real. It is real. It's real life. That happens. Whether they are wrong or right, I try to listen, listen, listen. That's how I flip the script, right? I listen to what they say. They may think I ain't paying attention, but I see your message and I got you one. Sometimes learning means knowing what not to do and who not to follow, right? Even when people say that they are in your corner, you have to assess for yourself whether they really are, right? Recognize that what they say about you may not be accurate. It may not even make you feel good. It's probably not Christianly, but all you can do is transcend their words and behaviors and stay strong and grow. It's important that you reflect. Think about your happiness, your passions, your priorities, your relationships with the Lord, and all other things that are important. Be honest, be diligent, be a high achiever. Dream big. I never talk about being an overachiever. I think it's an insult. Only God knows what we can achieve. How can it be over? Do you know your potential? I don't even know my potential. I am a high achiever, always aspiring for the stars, right? So, I'm a psychologist, and I've been a little psychological, but I want to give you a little therapy. I like to do that. One of the things that I've told my patients, I don't see patients anymore, a little too much drama for me, but I've worked with hundreds. I tell my patients that there is beauty on the other side of suffering. But the power comes from working through it, understanding it, going through, doing your work around it. If you can't get stuck in the suffering, you have to move past it. You have to persevere. You have to find your power, find your peace, and work through the pain, okay? Don't get paralyzed by drama or the trials of life. We all have storms and challenges. We're supposed to count it all joy. You must move through your obstacles, like Wilma, like Langston, like our ancestors, and like those in your family who have struggled and survived. Pain is a process that should not be ignored or neglected. Get to the beauty that comes from suffering, like Jesus Christ. He suffered for us, and as a result, we are all beautiful. We too must work hard despite our obstacles and limitations, focusing on our strengths. We must first, as a people and as individuals, learn to love ourselves and love our people. Not in a narcissistic, I think I'm cute way, but in a I love who I am trying to become and who I am creating amongst myself, right? I said I was closing. So hopefully by now I have flipped the script and come full circle. And I ask you in closing to reflect on what matters most in your life based on what you deem as successful, not anyone else. Booker T. Washington says, success is not what you accomplish. He talks about how it's what you have overcome to get there, okay? So you think about that, whether it's being loving, learning, listening, laughing, luxuriating, or leaning on the Lord, or in the multiple choice option, all of the above. I just hope that you don't forget there is a world, a circle beyond all these circles I've been talking about today, a circle beyond the earth. There's eternal life. Thank you.